Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Jesus, He never fails. Jesus, He never fails. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but Jesus never fails. Jesus, He never fails. Jesus, He never fails. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but Jesus never fails. I have tried a man, He never failed. I have tried a man, He never failed. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but Jesus never fails. Won't you trust Him, He'll never fail. Won't you trust Him, He'll never fail. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but Jesus never fails. Jesus, He never fails. Jesus, He never fails. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but Jesus never fails. I have tried Him and He never failed. I have tried Him and He never failed. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but Jesus never fails. Won't you trust Him, He'll never fail. Won't you trust Him, He'll never fail. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but Jesus never fails. Praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. Truly, that's the song sentiment of our heart, not only today, but as we've been serving the Lord down through the years, that He never fails. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but Jesus never fails. And there's another song that says that you can build your hopes on nothing less but Jesus Christ and His righteousness. He's our everything. He's our all in all. I'm so glad that He is our Savior that cares for us. As we get ready to go before the Lord in prayer, we certainly want to remember men and women and children everywhere that the Lord will continue to save and add to the church daily, such as should be saved. Our first priority should be Jesus' first priority, and that's to save that which is lost. And He came and did just that. And then He heals. So our priority should be that the Lord will heal both spiritually and naturally and emotionally and financially. All aspects of an individual's life, we pray for healing and divine intervention. And then we should also pray that we be effective witnesses. So let us pray that the Lord will bless us to be great witnesses unto Him. It reminds me of the scripture where Jesus was telling His disciples after His showing Himself alive, after the Bible says in the book of St. Luke, chapter number 1, after His passions, after His showing Himself alive, that He told them that they were going to receive power after that the Holy Ghost would come upon them. And then they were to be witnesses unto Him in Judea, Samaria, and under the uttermost parts of the world. So let us pray that we be those effective witnesses that the Lord is calling for us to be in these last and evil days, and that we be servants of the kingdom. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. To be a servant of the Lord. And let us pray for our country, that the Lord will bless this great America, that people will literally come to their senses. Amen. And do what's right that's in the sight of the Lord. And pray also too for the world that the Lord will continue to bless. Pray for those that are grieving and bereaving and those that are in the hospitals. Pray for those that are going through all conditions that we may be the servants that the Lord is calling for. Let every heart pray. O gracious Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we certainly do thank You. And we praise You, Lord, for Your great power and Your great anointing. We ask you, Lord, that you bless each and every servant of the Lord that is under the sound of our voice. Remember men and women and children everywhere, Lord. You save and add to the church daily such as should be saved. Encourage our hearts and strengthen us in our spirit, our soul, and our bodies. Bless, Lord, each and every request that's been made known and each and every unspoken request. Lord, we pray in the name of Jesus that you strengthen us, Lord, that you bless us on every hand. We ask you, Lord, that you bless our Bible study on today, that you grant us wisdom and knowledge and understanding. Keep us, Lord, in the center of your will. Father, we thank you and praise you, give you glory and honor. In Jesus' precious and mighty name, amen and amen. Thank you, Lord. We certainly do thank God. Amen. I was expecting more of our students out, but as we don't want to prolong our service, but we do want to move forward in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Lord. And it's good. I thank God that you all have persevered and come out to the household of faith to hear a word from the Lord. Amen. And as we get ready to move forward, I just wanted to highlight our quiz. What I'll do, just to wait for more people to come. Amen. Sister Jackie, I have the quiz over there on that shelf over there. And if you could pass it out to the adult figures that are here, and then give one to those that come in. Thank you, Lord. And just turn my heat up just a little bit on that wall. Thank you, Jesus. And as we won't review our quiz just this moment, but we'll go into our lesson. We'll go into our lesson, and then we'll hit our quiz as we look toward moving it forward. Thank you, Lord. We have been talking about vision, and looking at vision on today, we want you to turn with us to the book of Proverbs, chapter 29, verse 18. Proverbs 29 and verse 18. And it's important for us to have a vision. A vision represents a revelation from God concerning the will of God for your life. And last week we talked about Jesus received a vision from the Father, which equated to his mission, his purpose, and what he was designed to do. When God gives you and grants you a vision, a godly vision is in line with God's purpose for your life. And it's God's prerogative. I want you to hear me when I say this. It's God's prerogative to hide a thing. And it's our initiative to search it out. And it's our joy, and it should be our delight to search out what God has hid. And as we search it out, God reveals. God opens it up. And that's the way God has designed it. The Bible says that God is a rewarder to them that diligently seek him. God wants you to put forth effort to seek after him. When you seek after God with all your heart, with all your might, with all your strength, it separates, the Bible says, the wheat from the tare. It those who desire it, those that want it, will go after it. Jesus said a lot of parables concerning the kingdom of heaven or the gospel. That it's if the gospel or the kingdom of heaven is like a hidden treasure that is in a field, and people sell all that they have to find it. And that's what God wants you to do. God literally, he wants you to sell all that you have to search after him, to go after him with all your strength and all your might. So God conceals certain things only
to be revealed for those that desire it, those that go after it. That's why the scripture says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So is vision. Vision, I said all that to say this, vision is like unto that. When you come into the body of Christ, when you come into connection with God, the first thing you should say is, why am I here? Amen. After the Lord saves you and fills you with the Holy Ghost and you get baptized in the name of Jesus, your first question should be, Lord, what would you have me to do? Why am I here? And it's not up to the pastor or for the leadership that is in the church to tell you what you should be doing in God's kingdom. It's for you to search it out. Amen. It's for you to go after it and find out why you are here, why God has you here, why or what you are to be doing. Amen. And in line with that, God gives you a vision. God gives you a vision. Amen. So vision then, in this context, especially in Proverbs, we want to read Proverbs 29 and 18. It says, where there is no vision, the people perish, but he that keepeth the law, happy is he. And what that scripture is saying is, it's talking about when an individual doesn't have a vision, a divine vision from God. And it says the people perish. In other words, if you don't have a divine vision of your assignment, of what you are supposed to be doing in God's kingdom, his revelation, the revelation from the Lord, the people live without restraint. In other words, the people live are like a ship without a sail. They are living their life without a compass. In other words, they have no direction. They live without restraint. They have no focus in their life. And that's what a godly vision brings to an individual. And as we progress in our class, we're going to bring this out even the more. Godly vision brings purpose to your life and focus. It gives you a reason to wake up in the morning. It gives you a reason to help you to make tough decisions. When you have know your purpose and know the function that you have in life, it helps you to make tough decisions of whether to go left or whether to go right or to stay the course. It helps you to deny ungodliness and worldly lust. It helps you to love people the way they ought to be loved because you have a motivation. You have a function. You have a purpose. So in this particular scripture, it says, where there is no vision, the people perish. In other words, where there is no revelation, people cast off restraint. And part B of that says, but blessed, but he that keepeth the law of God, happy is he. In other words, blessed is the one who heeds God's wisdom or God's instruction or God's law. We all know, that's why you're here at Bible study, that it's better to obey God's word than not to obey the word of God. It's better to walk in the will of God than not to walk in the will of God. And the Bible says that those that walk in the will of God, they are blessed. Amen? Why are you blessed? Because you're under God's protection. You're shielded by God that protects you from danger seen and unseen. He provides for you. He watches over for you. Amen? He heals you. He delivers you. Now, let me say this. Does God heal and protect people that are outside of his will? Of course he does. But those that are in a special relationship with him, he cares more for them. because they are his children. He's obligated, if you allow me to say it, to take care of those that put his trust, that put their trust in him. It's like I'm obligated to take care of my children, more so than those that are just my neighbors, if you allow me to say it like that. There's a special bond, there's a special covenant relationship that I have with my children. There's a special bond and covenant. God sees you and knows you, and you're trusting in him. There's a special elevation in the relationship with him. That's what the meaning of when it says you are blessed. Amen? Y'all with me? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I'm blessed. You blessed. The scripture says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. You can say of the Lord, he is my refuge. Amen? Hallelujah. I'm glad to call the Lord my refuge, my fortress, amen, and my strength. Amen? I couldn't always say that. Hallelujah, when I was outside of the will of God. But as we say, the safest place in the whole wide world is in the will of God. Hallelujah. So that's what that scripture means there. And as we move forward, I want to move forward in talking about physical vision and spiritual vision. What you can see with your eyes, physical vision. There's certain things that you see with your eyes that resonates in your mind and helps you to know that these things are real. And just as real is spiritual vision. I want us to get that. Because if you don't get that, then you're lost. What God reveals to you in the spiritual is just as abiding as what you can see in the natural. Just as real. Amen? Just as real. Amen? Just as real. And when God reveals something to you, especially through the scriptures, it's just as real as you can see it before your face. Amen? Thank you, Lord. And God gives you an imagination. The enemy tries to corrupt your imagination. Hallelujah. But God gives you an imagination so that you can see in the spirit. So that you can see literally what God sees. God will show you in the spiritual what he sees. And it's just as real as what you can see in the natural. Amen? Hallelujah. That's why in the book of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter number 10, it tells us that we cast down imagination and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. That scripture is literally saying, don't allow any imagination or anything that you can see with your eyes or anything that would come to your mind spiritually, amen, to be exalted above what God shows you, amen. Spiritually, God looks at us as being giants, more than conquerors, am I right? God looks at and says us in his word, which is his vision. We got to catch it, my God. I feel the Holy Ghost. That we can do all things through Christ. That's God's vision. Amen for you. Through Christ, that's what? Strengthens us. That our strength comes through Christ. Amen? And that's God's vision for you to be more than a conqueror. To be an overcomer. And our imagination, those things that come up against us, we should not allow our own imagination to exalt itself above that. Amen. What do you mean, Brother Pastor? That I should not let my own thoughts say that, well, I don't know, I can't do it. I don't know, I can't make it. I'm not qualified enough. Amen. Those are our own thoughts that are exalting themselves. Amen. And those old thoughts that you have, they're negative spiritual visions that don't originate from God. Whoa, that's deep. Amen. I cannot allow visions, spiritual visions, to come into my mind that don't originate from God. Y'all with me? You always got to fight against that. Amen. One thing that I've learned, hallelujah, my God. One thing that I've learned that if you can check this out for yourself and realize that the reality of what I'm saying, where God created everything, he created also an opposite of it. Where there's light, there's darkness. Where there's good, there's evil. Amen. Where there's tall, there's short. Amen. Everything that God created and put into existence, there's an opposite. Amen. So the enemy, the devil, he's evil, isn't he? And his job and his mission is to do what? Steal, kill, and to what? Destroy you. And he's really trying to destroy you through the vision that God has given you. The enemy attacks the vision that God gives you. Because he'll help you to do anything else, amen, except the will of God. Amen? Amen? The devil will help you do whatever you want to do. Amen? He'll touch people's minds to get you off track. Amen? Why? Because he's evil. Am I right? He comes against the spiritual vision of God. Hey, glory. Hallelujah. Y'all with me? Thank you, Lord. So what does he attack? He attacks your imagination. Amen? Especially the spiritual imagination that God has for you, which equates to the vision that God has for you. You see vision through your imagination. Amen? You see spiritual vision through your imagination. The enemy attacks your spiritual imagination. Amen? Where the Lord says you can, the devil says you can't. Where the Lord says you can't, the devil says you can. He's always fighting you with the opposite of God. That's huge. That's huge. So you know that if the enemy is leading you, you know that he's leading you when he's trying to get you to do that which is opposite of God. Amen? Hallelujah. Y'all with me? Jesus says that I'm the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. There's a false vine if there's a true vine. Am I right? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, because there's always an opposite. There's always an opposite. Hallelujah. And what the enemy is trying to attack you and get you is through your imagination, and that's where your vision is housed. Y'all with me? Hallelujah. So that's why we can't allow the enemy to interfere and how does the scripture say? Casting down imagination. You got to cast down everything that the enemy brings you that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Y'all with me? Y'all with me? Now, another part to this. Your vision comes through a knowledge of the Word of God. Hallelujah. That's why he says, don't let anything be exalted above God's word. That's why God wants you to study his word. If you're going to get the vision in your mind about your assignment, about what God wants you to have, you've got to have a knowledge of Him. Hallelujah. And then when you obtain the knowledge of Him, there's going to be an opposite. The enemy is going to bring you disinformation. Hallelujah. But you can't allow that disinformation to be exalted above God's revelation. Does that make sense? Y'all with me? Y'all understand what I'm saying? Hallelujah. If you don't understand what I'm saying, just raise your hand. Hallelujah. Because this is important. Amen? All right. Thank you, Lord. Now, let's move on then. Y'all ready for the next one? All right. So we talked about what vision is. Vision deals with revelation, comes from God. God puts that revelation into your spiritual imagination. Amen? Which operates and gets you to see what God sees. Amen? Your imagination is real. God didn't just give you that so that you can do certain things and so it can be corrupted. Hallelujah. You follow me? That your imagination is a gift from God. The enemy is opposite. He tries to corrupt it. Your imagination is where God gives you vision to allow you to see what He sees. And how do you see what God sees? Through the knowledge of Him. Through the study of Him. Amen? That gives you the revelation of Him. Amen? Which helps you to understand your assignment. Amen? The vision that God wants you to have. Y'all with me? Hallelujah. Let's move on. Oh, God, give me some hope. I ain't going to y'all. This is very important. Amen? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Because we're going somewhere. Amen? All right. Now, write this down. Your imagination, it influences your aspirations. Your imagination, it influences your aspirations. Your aspirations are what you're trying to attain or aspire to. What you're trying to achieve. A-S-P-I-R-A-T-I-O-S. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you. Yeah, it influences your aspirations. Or aspirations is simply what you're trying to achieve. What you're trying to attain. Amen. In other words, so man thinketh in his heart, so is he. If you can see it, you can achieve it. That seeing it is equivalent to believing. Hallelujah. And you want your imaginations to come from God. Amen. Hallelujah. The same way, he puts evil imaginations in people's hearts. Amen? And so they can see it, and then they go after it to achieve. Amen? Remember I said there's an opposite. Remember that. There's an opposite. Amen? Where there's good, there's evil. Paul said it this way. He said it this way in Romans chapter number 7. He said, when I would do good, amen. The opposite is always there, trying to bring you down. Amen. Then he said something very powerful. He said, thanks be to God that giveth us the what? Victory. Where is Your imagination influences your aspirations. What you're going to attain. What you're going to achieve. Your dreams determine your destiny. Amen?
Hallelujah.
Thank you. So let's go through this process. Amen. There are four stages in this process of accomplishing vision. Amen. You may say, well, Pastor Quinn, why do you keep harping on vision? Because this is where the Lord has us. And this is where He wants us to be. Amen. All right. The first step is you got to have a mission. First step is you got to have mission. And your mission really deals with the assignment that God wants you to have, that God has. The mission of the church is to save. Amen. Jesus gave the great commission, which is the mission, in the book of Matthew, I believe it's chapter 27. Amen. Mission is to make disciples. Amen. To save. Am I right? To preach the gospel. Am I right? If you're going to connect yourself to God, you got to connect yourself to God's overall mission. Amen. Let's go there real quick. Chapter 28. This is the mission of the church. You're going to line yourself up with God's vision. You've got to understand what the mission is. Amen. So the mission of God's church is in Matthew chapter 28, and it says, starts with verse 18. Save, to deliver, to set free. What do you mean by saying like that? It's because we always fall short. Amen. God wants you to be faithful in that. Am I right? We sometimes want to be faithful until you get hard. Am I right? But God wants you to continue to heal. But you've got to be dedicated to your goal. Amen. No mission. Know what your goal is, and know what the steps to take to get there. Amen. Now know what to do. Sister Jack.
Over. assignment.
Your vision, your assignment.
Yes.
And all of them lead to the mission.
Yes. be the deacon. Am I right? It takes a man. I'm from the study of the gospel, the preaching of the word. Amen. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. And then you usher it. It ain't good for you to try to do everything in service. Somebody else got to step up. Am I right? So forth.
Confident. Paul was so confident, he said, not
know, the problem with some people is that they haven't bought into God's vision. They haven't bought into their assignment. They haven't bought into the will of God being accomplished in their life. People that have bought into this thing, they live a different way. Hallelujah. Y'all with me? You ever heard, man, he's serious than a heart attack. Huh? Serious. You follow? Confident. I know in whom I believe. I know in whom I trust. Amen? I'm past the fight in my mind, am I saved? Am I going to heaven? Do I have the Holy Ghost? I'm past that. Amen? Why? Because I'm confident. I know I got it. I know I'm saved. I know I'm on my way to heaven. Confident. You follow me? Hallelujah. I took this afternoon, I took a vision IQ test. Amen? I took a vision IQ test. And the vision IQ test was about spiritual truths. You follow me? And guess what I got? I got 15 out of 15 right. Huh? And the thing came, I showed you, I took a screenshot of it. It said, you have a strong spiritual vision in the core values of God. You know what that did for me? It boosted my confidence. You follow what I'm saying? You got to be confident in this thing. Not the way you high-minded. Amen? You follow me? But know who you are. And whose you are. Why? Because the fight is going to come to you. Huh? The enemy, his vision is to steal, kill, and to destroy you. Y'all with me? Just a second, what'd you turn that heat up to? Oh, that's it?
Yeah.
Man, that baby working. Thank you, Jesus. Gotta be confident. All right, the next one. Because I want to get to my quiz. Thank you, Lord. The third one is hope. Amen? The fourth one, then, deals with your vision. Fourth one is vision itself. Amen? You got to have a vision. Amen? And that vision there is you got to have your revelation from God. In order to have your revelation from God, you've got to seek it. Now, what am I saying? What am I saying? That just because I can teach doesn't mean I'm a teacher. Just because I can exhort on the scriptures doesn't mean I'm a preacher. You follow me? Now, I just good at studying the word. Right? Preaching and teaching is a calling from God. Am I right? So, if, say, Sister Louise say, well, brother, I think you should be teaching and preaching. I get up there teaching and preaching, and I fall flat on my face. Whose fault is that? It's mine. It ain't Sister Louise's fault. It's my fault. Why? Because I didn't get it from God. Amen? You got to get it from God. You follow me? You got to get it from who? God. So in order for me to get it from God, I got to seek Him. I can't fit into a place where God has not called me. And I can't let other people put me in a place where God has not called me. You follow? Just because I like young people doesn't mean I should be over them. Huh? Just because I've been married 30 years don't mean I should be teaching a married two people's Bible class. Maybe them 30 years wasn't good. Maybe she just didn't divorce my tail. You follow me? There's a difference. You understand what I'm saying? So my vision has to come from God. Y'all with me? Thank you, Lord. So, in looking at your assignment, looking at what God has called you to do, looking at your hope, your confidence, your vision, your goals, amen? All of this comes from seeking after God. Amen? Can't get it unless you seek after him. Can't get it unless you seek after him and be faithful. Amen? Y'all with me? Now, just one more thing. One more thing, then we'll cut this portion off. Amen? With the mission, going back to the mission, with the mission, God puts you in a physical building, amen, called the church, a physical building called the church. Y'all with me? So that you can work out your goals and assignments. Follow me? Each church has a different vision, overall vision, to fulfill the mission. Just like each person has a different role to play. Follow me? Y'all with me? Hallelujah. Here, our vision is to be a caring fellowship, leading souls to Christ, strengthening members and families, making disciples, equipping them for service and community ministry. That's our vision. That's what the God has given unto me. That's what I'm teaching you. Amen? You follow me? Now, does Pastor Quinn fulfill all of those assignments that are written down there? No! We do collectively. We do together. Amen? We all have a part to play in it, to accomplish it. You follow me? We got to do our part. Y'all with me? Don't be afraid of what man said. Amen? Don't allow the devil to put imagination in your mind to tell you you can't do it. When that happens, that should be a red flag and still telling you you can do it. Because the devil will always tell you the opposite. Amen? I'm teaching right now. I hope y'all receive it. You're stronger than what you think. That's why he said, let the weak say I'm what? Be strong in who? The Lord. And in the power of who? Amen. His might. Amen? Put on the whole armor of what? God. That you might be able to what? Amen. Stand. Huh? When the evil day comes. When the enemy tries to take your vision. Stop you from completing your assignment. Now, I said all that to say this, that when you know that, it makes living holy that much sweeter. When you know that God has called you and you're confident in it, when the enemy tries to bring you sin, when the enemy tries to tempt you, you can be like Jesus and say, get thee behind me, Satan. Yeah, the physical church, which is to carry out the mission and the vision that he gives to that church. He gives that to the pastor. Amen? And then you line up with the assignment. It's where you function. You perform the assignment, the goal that God has given you. Amen? Everybody should be working. Am I right? There's always something to do, isn't it? My God in heaven. The devil is always busy, isn't he? How do you find your assignment? You seek after God. Amen? God has already led you to a place. You line up with the vision. To promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen? Through effective, responsible ministry and intentional, creative, dynamic fellowship. What is that gospel? Huh? I get baptized, I repent for all of my sins, I fulfill the mission. I get baptized in the name of Jesus. That's the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. That's how you fulfill that assignment, to get baptized in the name of Jesus. And I become a disciple. That means that I transform my life. Amen? Being buried with him in baptism. Hallelujah. Being born again of the water and of the Spirit. Am I right? He gives you the Holy Ghost. Am I right? To what? Empower you. So that you can have a life with him. So that you'll be empowered to fulfill your goals. Because when he gives you the Holy Ghost, he also gives you gifts. Amen? Sister Quinn has different gifts than I have. Sister Louise got different gifts than I have. Brother Terrell has different gifts than I have, but where all of our gifts are still working toward the same purpose. Amen? And I need your gift. I need what you got. Amen? And not only that, I should develop, when I say I am talking about you, you should develop a discernment of who's got what gift. You follow? So he's got a gift of faith. And if I get low, ding, 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 ding. So this means, how you doing? She said, oh, man, you're on my mind. I have. I love a good anointed service and good preaching and singing. Well, I'll say about this one. Good singing is going on, and when I do, I sit back and I look around the audience. I see who getting into it, and the Lord may reveal something to me. So I sneak over to him. I grab the oil. I sneak over to him. He's giving me that gift. Huh? Lay hands on him. You follow me? Thank you, Lord. And I miss all the call because he's giving me the gift of discernment. I lay hands on you, and it's like a connection. I can see through the Spirit what you're dealing with. They give me insight to pray. That comes from God. Isn't that necessary for me to fulfill the assignment? I got to know what to pray for. You may not say a word. Huh? But when I lay hands on you, it's a connection. Huh? Y'all didn't know that, did y'all? She said you got to be effective. And the gifts that God gives you causes you to be effective. Amen? I know him. I'm just trying to give you some examples. Amen? Some people can come up for prayer. I lay hands on them. And it feels like boo. God let me know that they're not the will of God. That's how he lets you know. So I try to get him back into the will of God. He doesn't give you to belittle people. It's insight. Amen? To fulfill the goal. Woo! I'm teaching right now. God doesn't give you your gift so that you can look down on people, so that you can think that you're better than people, but he gives it to you so you can help. So you can diagnose. Amen?
Done with vision. Tune in on next week as we continue.